Bible, and we're going to be going through Wednesday night, tonight, tomorrow night, Tuesday night, and Wednesday night. Every night at 5:30, we'll have worship from 5:30 to 6, and we'll turn them loose. Is this your first revival, Brother Daniel, since your accident?
I've done one.
You've done, this is your second one? This is his second revival since his accident, you know, when he fell down the stairs in Orlando. Just pray for him. I know that he's still dealing with healing. He gets a little tired, he says, sometimes when he preaches. So y'all just be in prayer for him this week, that the Lord use him to give us what we need, and most of all that we're edified. I'm excited about this. You know, with this COVID and everything, I was telling him this morning, it seems like all churches, he was telling me that T.D. Yates' church that holds 15,000, about 25 on Sundays. So it's every church. But I do know this, we've got a core that's ready for revival, and we've got a bunch watching it at home and is excited about this revival, and I'm ready to get poured into. I'm not going to go into no spill. We'll stand. Everybody will stand. We'll take up our tithes and our offerings. We'll do a love offering every night. If you want to sow into Brother Daniel, our church always makes sure he gets an X amount of dollars. But if you want a blessing, then you could sow into that, because I know it's a fruitful ministry. But this is our Sunday church tithe, so. At this time, the Bible says, bring your alms and your tithes to the storehouse. So at this time, will you do so? I was out of town last week. You can go ahead and give him lights if you want to, James. We're going to worship. I was out of town last week, and me and the family was on vacation, so this is my first service for 2021. I know everybody's ready for 2020 to be behind them. Don't know if anything's going to change as far as the coronavirus for a while, but ready for a new year, ready for a new beginning, if you will. But here's what I do know. God's not changed. God's the same yesterday as he is today, as he will be tomorrow. And he inhabits, he desires praise and worship. If you want to get close to God today, just worship him. Just come into his court for praise and thanksgiving. God's been too good to us for us not to do that. I'm not going to get in there and preach a little bit like I always do before we start service. I'm going to leave that to Brother Daniel this week. I'm at a point in my life where I'm ready to be poured into. A little empty, so I need to be filled up. So we're just going to start off with prayer, and then we're going to go into our worship. Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we love you. We thank you, God. Lord, I thank you for an awesome God. Lord, I thank you, Lord, that you're in control. Lord, I thank you, Lord, that the only thing that we can bring to the table today, Lord, is worship and praise, Lord. Lord, you do the rest. Lord, I know that it puts a smile on your face to see these people come in here for this revival today, Lord. Lord, let us be faithful to you, Lord, most of all. But Lord, let us be faithful this week to come and be attentive with the man of God saying, Lord, speak through him. Put him to the side, Lord. Lord, I thank you for healing him, Lord. I thank you for giving him strength enough to come and preach this revival, Lord. I know as I stood in prayer this morning, I called on you, Lord, to pour into me,
water you turned into wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. There's none like you. Into the dark she shines. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. There's none like you. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Awesome in power, our God, our God. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God. Into the dark she shines. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. There's none like you. Our God. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than awesome in power, our God, our God. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God. For us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God. So our God. Great. your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you, Lord. So great. Great are you, Lord. You give life. To my darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that's been broken. Great are you, Lord. Great. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. Great. Singing great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, knees, bones will sing. Singing great. So we'll cry, knees, bones will sing, singing great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. Seated above, throne in the Father's love. destined to die, poured out for all mankind. God's only Son, perfect and spotless one. He never sinned, suffered as if he did. All authority, every victory is yours. All authority, every victory. Out, lighting this broken land. All authority, every victory is yours. And all authority, overcome. awesome in power forever. Awesome and great is your name. You are a king. I'm so thankful for a God that redeems.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise today, man. Come on, guys.
What a God.
Perfect, man. Cody, you got an anointing on your life, brother, besides a beautiful voice. An amazing, amazing talent. You're an asset to Witness Outreach Ministries. And you really make it easy to preach, brother. Thank you guys for coming and being here today. The worship and praise team is fantastic. I see progress. The last time I was here, it was me, a pastor, my two brothers in the sound booth, my dad, and a video camera. And look at this place today. Come on, guys. Let's love God today. This is awesome. This is the first message of 2021 for me, and I'm excited today for many reasons. The number one being that I've heard from God. Number two is that I feel like today, I'm so excited about what I'm going to preach. I feel like this is the most important message I have ever preached in 25 years of preaching. I really believe that in my heart. I'm not worried about time. I'm not worried about what time we're going to get out. Most of you, amen, it's been a while since you've been back home, so you're just trying to get, I'm going to let you get familiar with the territory this morning, all right? It's just good to see each one of you guys today. I want to thank the church for its love and support. I want to thank you for your prayers. I want to thank you for everything that you have contributed to my healing. I took a very nasty fall back in July. I lost my eyesight, had spinal shock, feet on fire. It felt like my toes were numb. The list goes on and on and on, and went through pure hell. I had to go to rehab, physical therapy. I had to learn to count again. I had to learn basically to do everything again. I had the hottest little nurse, amen, anybody could give, amen. Wendy took care of me and loved me through all of this, and my kids have been there to support their daddy. Being a guy that's always been in control, just a control guy, I'm a take charge guy. I'm not so much a follower, I can lead. I just jump out there and take off after it. I'm the type of guy, chase Moby Dick in a rowboat and take the tartar sauce with me, right? I've always been that kind of person. I'm a very strong personality type individual. And yet, at 47 years of age, I just turned 48 Monday, but at 47 years of age, I had my first encounter with being vulnerable. And it was somebody opening a door for me now while I'm on my walker. And going to rehab and having to count from 35 backwards by 5. And you're not stupid, you're not dumb, you know this is easy, you know you can do this, you know this is child stuff, but your brain won't let you. So I've went through a lot of healing over the last several months, and I've got a ways to go, a little further to go. But God's been faithful, God's been good. I haven't been able to work in about 6 months, 5-6 months, and done a little bit here and a little bit there, but we've totally come off the road. And I've done a little mini revival right by the house just to get back in the pulpit and test myself, whatnot. But in my heart, this is my first full-blown revival since my accident. And so I just can't think of a safer place to be, to where if I mess up, amen, I'll be forgiven. So I just want to thank you for being here this morning. I pray to God you guys will make it priority to be back. I'm driving an hour and a half one way every night to be here. And nobody in the room can say that. So I pray that you'll take time this week to come to revival. Guys, America needs revival. You need revival. Was it Spruce Pine needs revival? This church needs revival. Your pastor, by his own admission, needs revival. I got a text from a pastor this morning that told me that he was on he needed CPR. He was just needed revived. It's everywhere. COVID is unleashed on us. I've just had COVID myself. That was back in December, still dealing with it. It's like thick tar in my chest. I just can't get it out. It was probably one of the worst sicknesses physically I've ever been through. It was tough. But nonetheless, God's been faithful. And you've been faithful to be here this morning. And I want to just extend a bit of gratitude. Abby has her boyfriend with her today, Ashton. And Abby's had probably 3 or 4 boyfriends over the last couple of weeks. I mean, the last couple of... over the last year, I guess you'd say. But this young man's a good boy. And he's the first one that Abby's brought home that I really have a heart for. And Ashton's not real familiar with church. And so we find it an honor that he's with us today. And I would just ask you to pray for him. He's in a tough place in his young life, a place that no young man should have to be. I won't go into any detail. Just when you pray for Ashton, that God will direct his footsteps and help him as a young man to find his way in life. And he's a good boy. I'm proud, amen, that Abby's dating him. So with that said, amen, I want to welcome you, Ashton, not only here, but to the house of the Lord, in the presence of the Lord. And I pray that this today, this morning and tonight, not only Ashton, but you and myself, we will get what we came for today. Amen? With that said, this morning, I want to invite you to turn with me today, if you will, to the book of Numbers, the 21st chapter. Chapter 21 of the book of Numbers today. Numbers chapter 21. When you have found that, and you will this morning, please stand with me for the reading of the word of the Lord. If you do not have your Bibles with you, there's two things to that. Number one, shame on you for not having it. And number two, amen, we'll put it on the screen for you. All right? Amen. All right. Should have your word with you, guys. Amen. Should always have your word with you. You can't trust all these guys in the pulpit, just me and Brian, right? Amen. Amen. Numbers chapter 21 this morning. I'm going to take my time through this. I have to. Due to my physical ability, I'm just going to have to just take my time through this. This is a brand new message for me. It just come off the press in the last couple of days. So I hope it ministers to your heart. I hope it challenges you today. And I started to put this off till Monday and go a different route this morning. But I really feel compelled that if I don't do this, I'm going to regret it when I leave this morning. So just sit back, let the Lord minister to you. The Bible says in verse 2, "And Israel vowed a vow unto the Lord, and said, If thou wilt indeed deliver this people into my hand, then I will utterly destroy their cities. And the Lord hearkened to the voice of Israel and delivered the Canaanites." Somebody say the Canaanites. "And they utterly destroyed them in their cities, and he called the name of the place Hormah. And they journeyed from Mount Hor to the way of the Red Sea to compass the land of Edom." I want you to watch this. "And the soul of the people was much discouraged." Look at me for a minute. Not by the war they had with the Canaanites, but because of the way the Lord was taking them. Did you hear what I just said? Their soul was discouraged within them, not by the war. They weren't upset about the war. They won the war. Okay? What they're discouraged about is the way the Lord is operating, or the path he's chose to take them on. Can I tell you that sometimes it's not the war that gets you, it's the way he takes you. Everybody in this room has a story. I have a story. Ashton has a story. My wife has a story. Your pastor has a story. Sis, you got a story. This is the first time I've been in church with you and him not with you. There's little fellas in the room right now who's lost their daddy. I loved your daddy. I think about him often in sound booth. Thought about him way before we booked this revival. Riding down the road, he was on my heart and mind. And I prayed for your family. Ashton, you're not the only one in the house without a father. There's other young men and young women in the room without a father too. It ain't the war that often gets us. It's the way God takes us. You're strong when it comes to the war, but you're weak when it comes to the journey. "And the people spake against God and against Moses, Wherefore have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there's no bread, there's neither any water, and our soul loatheth this light bread." In other words, this ain't getting it, God. "And the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people, and much people of Israel did what?" Say it again. They died.
Therefore, the people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned. We dropped the ball. We fumbled. This has not been a misdemeanor. We've committed a felony, for we have spoken against the Lord, and we've spoken out against you, Moses. Pray unto the Lord, would you, that he would take away the serpents from us." And Moses prayed for the people. Last verse. "And the Lord said unto Moses, make thee a fiery serpent and set it up on a pole." Make thee a fiery serpent. This don't make a lick of sense to me or to you, but it will here in just a moment. "Make you a fiery serpent, set it up on a pole," and I want you to listen to this, "and it shall come to pass that everyone that is bitten, when he looketh up on it, shall live." Amen. Okay? It's a bit of a complex story, so if you'll sit down, buckle up, lay your Bibles to the side. I'm going to take you on a journey today that closely relates where we are right now in this room, in this season of our lives. "It shall come to pass that everyone that is bitten..." I want to preach to you today. I struggled with this title a little bit, but I think I hit the hammer, got the nail right on the head, and that is, it matters which way you look. It matters which way you look. "It shall come to pass that everyone that is bitten," everyone that has contracted it, everyone who has it in their system, everyone who tested positive, everybody that's been affected, everyone that has faced discouragement, everyone that has been going through hell, everyone that has experienced loss, everyone that is bitten, when he looketh upon God, shall live. Came into this house today to tell somebody it matters not what you've been through in the last several months. No matter if you've contracted COVID-19 as I have or not. No matter if you've lost your eyesight in the last 6 months due to a fall that left you in the trauma center for 5 days. Doesn't matter what your situation. Doesn't matter if you've lost your dad, lost your mom, lost your husband. Doesn't matter if half the church is missing right now, brother, and you don't know what you're going to do, amen, with a deleted budget. Doesn't matter if Joe Biden, amen, steps into the White House and Kamala Harris, amen, takes his position in the next year. Come on. It doesn't matter if we lost the Senate, lost the Congress, lost it all. It doesn't matter, amen, it doesn't matter if you got a job or if you lost your job. It doesn't matter if you're Democrat or Republican. It doesn't matter if you sleep like a baby or walk the floors with insomnia. No matter if it's Donald Trump or Joe Biden, I come to tell you what does matter is which way you look. Everybody's got a problem right now. Everybody's got a problem right now with where they're looking. The Word of God declares, everyone that looketh upon him shall live. Not everybody that looks upon them, but everybody that looks upon him shall live. The word live here in the Hebrew is kayai. Kayai simply means to keep alive, to nourish, to quicken, to repair, restore, and revive. It means to make whole. So it matters where you look. Anybody agree with that? If you want to be refreshed, if you want to be made alive, if you want to be nourished, if you want to be repaired and restored and made whole, then it matters which way you look. And Moses made a serpent of brass and put it upon a pole, and it came to pass that if a serpent had bitten any man, when he beheld the serpent of brass, he lived. It matters which way you look. Okay, brother, you've said that 10 times. I'm going to say it 25 more times. I'm going to tell you something else I'm going to do in this revival. I am totally open. I am totally open to the will of God, and I have been delivered from this religious pulpit complex that people don't put on us only, but that we put ourselves only due to our egos, our arrogance, and our self-independence, that every time we come to a pulpit, we must preach something different. Mm-hmm. I'm not doing that this year. If you don't get this morning, and I will know before I leave, you're going to get it again tonight. And if you don't get it tonight, I'll preach this message again Monday night. Well, if you keep doing that, brother, ain't nobody going to show up. My eyes are on him. God gave me this word to preach to you. And until you get it, I think it is a felony for me to move on to something different. We got to get beyond this, Brian. We got to get beyond it. Either we hear from God or we don't hear from God. It's one thing for me to hear from God, but if you don't hear what God's told me, amen, then the truth is, you ain't got it. I'm not being ugly. I'm simply saying you matter to me. You matter to me. Your marriage matters to me. Your finances matter to me. This ministry matters to me. Spruce Pines matters to me. This man and his wife and babies matter to me. This church and ministry that has undergirded us for so many years and held our arms up when we were weak and tired. It goes beyond a friendship with Brian. It goes beyond dear honey. It's way beyond Kansas, I can tell you that, baby. I mean, it's a spiritual bond that we have. It's a brotherhood of what God's called us to do. And one of the greatest things I've ever done wrong in the ministry is I allowed myself to go underneath the complex of feeling as though the pressures of people and flesh that I've got to push that to the side and go find something new. When I know good and well, amen, didn't take root. The truth is, it matters which way you look. I've been troubled lately because I look around and honestly for me, I have come off of social media. I had to. The reason I've had to come off of social media is because it's driving me nuts. Okay? It just does. I mean, to not have Facebook is so liberating to me in the aspect that I can now walk into Piggly Wiggly without hating the person, amen, I go to church with. Okay? Because I don't have to be on Facebook and see the ignorant stuff that they keep posting, which makes me biased in my view of them when I see them in public or even at church. Now I walk up, just love, kiss all of them. Hey, man, how you doing? Hey, I'm doing great. Man, it's so good to see you. When before, God, I turned to go the other way. Fox News, Newsmax, all this fake news and media hype is driving me crazy. The mention of Donald Trump has become as offensive to me as the name Joe Biden. Just has. I think he's the greatest president we've ever had in the history of this country. But I'm just sick of the hype, the build-up, and then all of a sudden the platform unleashes and I'm hanging again. The disappointment, the discouragement, the frustration, the anxiety, the stress. Since I've come off of social media, I'm sleeping better. I haven't been able to sleep since I had a fall. All I've been doing is laying in the bedroom, taking medication and watching news. Watching this, watching that, peddling this and peddling that. And I'm doing my best to try to come off this stuff and evade. Because it matters which way I look. Things that I watch and things that I keep putting in my system and things that I heard something about them blocking Trump off of Facebook and blocking him off of Twitter and then you hear about the Ayatollah and everything that they put on there and then the list goes on. And now somebody called me this morning, 7:10, brother, I got to talk to you and I want to encourage you. I thought, hey, I can always use encouragement. So I picked the phone up and I answered it. And before I can even say hello, brother, I want you to know right now they've arrested Nancy Pelosi. They found Adam Schiff. Amen. They're fixing to require martial law. Amen. I'm telling you right now, I got some inside information. That's the thing that's why I got some inside information. And you better get 2 weeks worth of gas right now. Antifa's fixing to go crazy. Black Lives Matter's fixing to go nuts. Brother, you better get ready for war. We're fixing to have it. And I'm thinking, this is encouragement? This is someone who supports our ministry financially. These are people that check on us since I've been hurt. These are people that love us. We're not talking about fruitcakes. We're not talking about nut jobs. We're talking about people that are Christians. They love the Lord. They love their country. They love their president. But they're so caught up in this mess, brother. This guy honestly thinks Nancy Pelosi has been arrested this morning when she's on MSNBC at 9 o'clock attacking Trump. Now, you can't be in both places, Nancy. And I had to just stop him and tell him, listen to me, brother, listen to me. I love you, but the thing that's always made me attractive to you, brother, is the fact, amen, that I always tell the truth and I won't dance. And I'm not going to start dancing with you now. I love you enough to tell you right now, turn that mess off. Get away from it, brother. Go get in the presence of God. You're eat up with hypertension.
Man, I mean, if you're not careful, you'll get into a place in your life, amen, to where... Boy, I done tore something up, amen. You'll get into a place in your life, amen, to where if you're not careful, amen.
There you go, brother.
If you're not careful, amen, the next thing you do, you're possessed and oppressed by which way you look.
David said, I will. Means a deliberate act of your will. I will look unto the hills from which cometh my help. My help. My assistance. The thing that lowers my blood pressure. The thing that lowers my stress. The thing that does away with the anxiety. The thing that helps me rest at night. The thing that gives me clarity of mind. The thing, amen, that causes me to operate and function with the right kind of thinking is I look unto the Lord. My help comes from the Lord. This particular text I've shared with you today is built on a premise that the children of Israel are traveling through a wilderness. Somebody say a wilderness. Get ready. Here I come. My intro is over with. It's time to preach. If there ever were a time that the people of God were traveling through a wilderness, it is not only in the ancient writ of the Word of God as the children of Israel were traveling from Egypt to the Promised Land, it is also true today that many of us sitting in this room find ourselves in the same place, the wilderness. I started to do this before I preached, and I knew I would forget to do it. And then once I got started preaching, I remembered it that I forgot to do it. But it fits real good right here, right now. Can we pull our mask off for just a second? And please don't raise your hand or stand with me or just because the person beside you did it, and you look like a moron if you don't. How many of you be honest right now, brother? I'm just not happy. Raise your hand. Just two of us. Thank you for your honesty, brother. Brother, I just don't have the level of joy that I used to. Anybody with me? Okay, I knew we wasn't alone. All right. Brother, my hunger for God is just not where it should be. Brother, my thirst and my passion for Him is just not as intense as it needs to be. Okay, with all of that said, then this will be unanimous, because I'm going to raise my hand. How many of you will join me right now today on the 10th day of January, 2021? How many of you would join me making a comeback? Come on, guys. Can I tell you that comebacks aren't easy? Can I tell you that comebacks are some of the most difficult, it's one of the most difficult things you'll ever experience in your life. It's worse than trying to lose weight. You know, losing weight physically is a mental problem. Trying to create a mental thing, but trying to make a comeback spiritually is warfare. It's warfare. It's a total change of priorities. It's to have to learn to readapt. Rethink, reprogram. It is a process of unplugging. It is an ongoing process of saying no to what your flesh craves, desires, wants. And here's the problem. What it's got used to. Having its way. It's not easy making a comeback. It's easy to raise your hand right now because Brother Couch did, so it's safe for the rest of us to do so. Because if he raised his hand first, then we know this ain't set up. Huh? So if he'll raise his hand first, amen, then you know what? Yeah, I can do it. I'm safe. I can do it. But I wonder if you'll be back tonight at 5:30, tomorrow night at 5:30. I wonder how faithful you'll be. As faithful to this as you would be taking your kids to a ball game? As faithful to this as you are trying to go to work, amen, for employment? As faithful to this as you are the other things in your life. See, if you want true revival, let me tell you something about real revival. I don't know if we'll have one this week or not. That's not up to me. That's up to you. Because true revival will destroy everything your flesh lacks. So, maybe I should have said that before I ask who wants to come with me on a comeback. The truth is, amen, is... if there ever were a time the people of God were traveling through a wilderness, it is today.
It's also true that many of us sitting in this room find ourselves at the same place, the wilderness. Now, the problem with a wilderness is that a wilderness has no highways. A wilderness has no street signs. A wilderness has no street lights. A wilderness has no paths, and a wilderness has no certainty. If you make a wrong turn in a wilderness, you may very well die. So again, it matters today, right now, amongst 80% of us that was honest and raised our hand, which way we look. I don't care if you were just born or 90 years old in a nursing home. Somewhere between your first cry and your last cry, you're going to find yourself in a wilderness. Preachers such as he and myself find ourselves in wildernesses. Our wives find themselves in the wilderness. Our kids sit back and look at their parents in a wilderness while on their way to church wearing a suit and tie and listening to Michael W. Smith. The truth of the fact of it is, you can be on this platform, Cody, and be in the wilderness. I know you can, because I've did it many times. Some of the greatest messages I ever preached in my life, the most powerful sermons God ever birthed through me, was while I was in the wilderness. Nobody knew it, but I did. I don't care. Listen, you can be in the wilderness sitting right beside someone who looks like they know where they're going. You can be in the wilderness on the platform singing Freedom Reigns, as bound up, amen, as a sinner down the street. You can be in a wilderness all the while preaching fire down from heaven. No one in this room is exempt from the wilderness. So don't come under a complex and beat yourself up if that's where you find yourself this morning. Because there's no one, I don't care how spiritual they are, how spiritual they look, how powerful they preach, how big their church is, there's no one who's exempt from the wilderness. Now I want you to sit back and eat this. Watch this closely. The biggest problem with the wilderness is that it often produces bewilderment.
That's so important.
You know, I've never heard that word in the church. I've heard wilderness, but I've never heard bewilderment. Bewilderment most always affects one thing, and that is your emotions. Think about that. That's what bewilderment does. In other words, it is impossible to be in a wilderness physically and not be affected emotionally. Come on, guys. If you're in a wilderness physically, it will have an effect on your emotions, creating a feeling of bewilderment. It is hard to hide bewilderment. You may do it for a little while, but you won't do it in the long run. You can do your best to cover it up, dress it up, and even paint it up with Estee Lauder makeup, but when you are imprisoned by bewilderment, the pain and loneliness will burn through your cover-up, and those around you will see vividly that you're not who God made you to be. I'm looking around this room tonight and this morning, and I'm telling you right now, this room is full of bewilderment. I didn't say anything about you being a bad person, an evil person, wicked, going to hell, out of the will of God. No. I'm just simply saying, there's a lot of you in this room who have been emotionally affected by the journey God has taken. I'm not blaming bad things on God. I'm just simply saying, if God can't get my attention by being good, then sometimes God will allow bad. Okay, I appreciate all three of you, but I know I'm right. It is hard to be nice when you're bewildered. It's hard to be polite when you're bewildered. It's hard to be politically correct when you're bewildered. It's hard to find motivation to move forward when you're bewildered. It's hard to be calm when you're bewildered. Everything gets on your nerves very quickly. Over nothing. It's hard to be happy when you're bewildered. It's hard to crack jokes when you're bewildered. It's hard to smile when you're bewildered. It's hard to pray when you're bewildered. It's hard to serve others when you're bewildered. Obedience is difficult when you're bewildered. Finding purpose for living is hard when you're bewildered. Bewilderment will affect your blood pressure. Bewilderment will affect your stress level. Bewilderment will have an effect on your life, your rest, your sleep, your mood swings, your temperament, your level of anxiety, and even your peace of mind. They are in the wilderness. Ladies and gentlemen, I have to tell you something this morning. America is in a wilderness. America is in a place of uncertainty right now. The stress has never been higher. The anxiety has never been higher. The frustration has never been higher. The division has never been great. Come on, folks. You know I'm telling the truth. Oh, you're going to make me preach this morning, ain't you? Hello? Huh? Discouragement, frustration. I have lived for 48 years as of this past Monday. And I can tell you something. In my 48 years of living, this is about as bad as I've ever seen it be. We have never had the variables collide like they have collided right now. Never. Let me explain that to you. The political climate that we're in. The spiritual decline America is in. Add to that a virus that we're yet to even define. It's already changed names 3 times. Thanks to Dr. Fauci, amen, who don't know his head from his... Okay. Amen. We're more confused as to how to handle this China virus than ever before. Now we watch as Trump is sent packing in exchange for a brain-dead Biden. The demonic Democrats now control all 3 branches of government. Our church institutions will be under attack like never before. America is in a wilderness. And normally when you're in a wilderness and everybody around you is there, usually in a wilderness, if they're stable, those around you, then you have options. You can lean on your friend. Lean on me when you're not strong, right? But I can't find anybody to lean on right now but my wife. My wife's doing fantastic spiritually. Sometimes I feel like my wife is being the leader of our home. I told her coming to church this morning. I said, honey, I'm making a comeback. It's been a tough year for me in 2020, and I ain't found anybody yet who would deny that for themselves. So I'm not saying that I'm an isolated case from anybody else in this room. Obviously, for others in this room, it's been a rougher year for them than it has been for me. Started out in January with the worst case of shingles my doctor's ever seen. I had a rash that started right here at my sternum, went all the way around underneath my armpit, all the way around the back of my bone, and then I started having severe nerve issues with it. So they put me on gabapentin. Gabapentin has 3 side effects, explosive rage, depression, and suicidal tendencies. I had all 3 of them. It's a miracle I'm even here right now because I contemplated more than once going out behind my building and just doing away with it. And Wendy began to watch me and look at me, and she thanked God for a wife, amen, who's focused. And she said, honey, she said, I think there's something going on with your chemical makeup right now with this medicine you're taking. And man, I blow my top. You leave my medicine alone. That's what I have to sleep at night. You ain't never had shingles. You don't know the pain that I'm having right now. That's the only thing that helps me sleep. You leave my pills alone. I'd never been addicted to pills in my life. Till now. I'd went from taking 100 milligram to 600 milligram before this thing was over with. And before I realized what was going on, it done had me by the throat, brother, choking the life out of me. Amen. And I went, I was in a revival in North Carolina, and God convicted me of it. And I went out to the trailer and got a big old bottle, probably $2,000 worth on the street market. Amen. I brought them in there, and I told them to turn the live stream off, and they turned it off. Amen. And I didn't want to embarrass the church and the pastor. And I asked him, I said, please forgive me. I've got a problem. Right in the middle of revival, right at the beginning of revival. It was a Sunday night. I'd preached that morning, and now I'm confessing my sin in front of the world, in front of everybody. And I poured out that whole bottle of pills in them altar, amen. And I said, I'm done with it. Took me 4 days to get that mess out of my system so I could finally go back to sleep. And then all of a sudden, amen, I slip and fall. Amen. And guess when I wake up in the trauma center, what they got me back on? Gabapentin. Been a devil trying to kill me this entire year. Come out of the trauma center. I came home, had to go through rehab, physical therapy. Ain't been able to work in months. That alone's enough to drive a man to his knees. The only one in my house working is my 18-year-old son, barely making minimum wage. But I ain't lost my car. Ain't lost my house. We ain't had to sit around and share the same bowl of cereal. I still eat Lucky Charms. I ain't even had to go to Corn Flakes. Come on, amen. Huh? I put on weight. The medicine that I needed, we've got it straightened out. They got me back on track. Physical therapy went great, went fine. Hey, amen. My wife didn't leave me. Hey, amen. My kids didn't forsake me. Hey, amen. I had time off to spend with my kids, time off to spend with my wife, time off with my daddy who was diagnosed with prostate cancer. Had to take his prostate out. I got to hang out with dad. It's been a learning curve for me from January to right now. Hey, amen. I had to experience vulnerability. Hey, amen. I had to experience humility. Hey, amen. I had to start all over again. Hey, amen. Used to be. Amen. We done so well in revival. Somebody walk up, put $100 bill in my hand. Amen. And to me, it was just some money. Thank you. I appreciate that. Put it in my pocket. The last 5-6 months, amen. If I get a 20, I go to dancing. Huh? Makes you grateful. Makes you thankful. Call rebooting, starting over. The truth of the fact of it is, America's in a wilderness. I know what a wilderness feels like. I didn't think anybody would ever want me anymore because I was broken. Has it been the case? My January is booked up. Half of my February is booked up. I've already started booking March and one in April. When everybody else is shut down, amen. Churches are shut down. Pastors trying to navigate their way through that thing. Evangelists, amen, have come off the field. They can't find nowhere to preach anymore. I'm getting traction again. Amen. Now while pastors are burned out, frustrated, upset, amen, now I'm coming on the scene refreshed, excited, ready to go. Got a word from God, amen. And now it's my opportunity to do for them what my wife has done for me. And that's lift up their hands, amen, in a time of battle. Everything's going to be all right. I'm telling you, amen, it won't stay like this forever. He that endureth unto the end. Normally when you're in a wilderness, everybody around you is stable and you have options to lean on your friends, but all our neighbors are in the wilderness. Italy is in a wilderness. Europe is in a wilderness. Asia is in a wilderness. Japan is in a wilderness. Australia is in a wilderness. You can't just pick up your phone and call someone who isn't talking about the virus, who isn't talking about hardship. You can't pick up your phone. None of you can. You don't know one person you can call that ain't going through hell. Everybody around us, it's like there's nobody to lean on who's stronger, because we all seem to be in the wilderness. It's amazing to me how a wilderness can change the tone of a narrative. You hear what I just told you? I said, it's amazing. Ain't nobody sitting around talking about Alabama football, are they? I noticed Brian didn't even wear his shirt today. It's true. You know exactly what I say is the truth. Huh? He actually dressed up today. Come on, amen. Huh? I love you, buddy. Listen, guys. The wilderness can change the tone of a narrative. Just no time ago, everybody was in tribalism and nasty and hateful to each other. Nothing good to say about anybody. But after 12 months of wilderness and counting, I've noticed that we seem to be understanding that we all have something in common now, and it's called a wilderness. Ain't nobody talking about the Baptist. The Baptist ain't talking about the Pentecost. Ain't none of us got anything negative to say about the Church of Christ. We welcome the Church of God. Why? Because we all have one thing in common. We're all in the same boat. I've noticed that we seem to be understanding that we all have something in common. It's called a wilderness. Outside of Washington, D.C., everybody seems to be starting to lean on each other, compassion for each other, talking civil to one another, and even reaching out to their neighbor for help. I said it's funny how a wilderness can suddenly change the narrative. Again, I say outside of Washington, D.C. Amen? Nothing like an enemy to help remind us that there's more to unite us than it is to divide us. I said nothing like an enemy to remind us that there's more to bring us together than separate us apart. It could be possible that God is all allowing the church to go through the wilderness to help us recognize that we've been petty at a time when we should be powerful. I tried to tell them this morning on the phone, brother, I know this is fixing to blow your mind what I'm fixing to say, and half of you ain't going to like what I'm fixing to say. But I'm going to say it anyhow, and I'm going to double down on it if I find out you don't like it. I think it's possible that this whole thing's orchestrated by God. The COVID, the job loss, the stress, the pressure, the anxiety, the frustration, the emptiness. Is it possible that God's allowing the people of God to go through this adversity to move us from the comfort zone to the field of evangelism? Is it possible that God is allowing this adversity in America or worldwide to move us from lukewarm living to a passionate craving for the presence of God? Because when I read my Bible, and correct me if I'm wrong, when I read my Bible, Israel was always top notch when they were going through hell. They always was maximized. The hotter the fire, the better they performed. The hotter the fire, the more hungry they were for God. The hotter the fire, the more thirsty they were for His will. I've noticed when 9/11 struck, every church was packed. Huh? There's something about conflict and something about adversity and something about hardship the church needs to learn to embrace. You don't know what I'm going through. You want to go there with me? Just when I come back getting on my feet and the eye doctor released me to drive again, I booked up 2 weeks of revival for December thinking we'd have a good Christmas this year to only get COVID-19. And I thought I'd quarantine just for 10 days. 10 days, I still felt like I don't know what. So I went on the 14 days, still felt like I didn't know what. I thought after 2 weeks of this mess, I should be over with. But my body was already so beat up and so worn down. Hey, man, I'm still dealing with it. And we're in the 10th day of January. The truth of the fact of it is, amen, the Bible says while they were in the wilderness, they had to fight the Canaanites. Have you ever had to fight while you're in the middle of a wilderness? If so, then you will agree with me. It's not fair, God. Things are already hard enough. Things are already difficult enough, and now I gotta fight. I'm already weak. I'm already bruised. I'm already hurt. I'm already sad. I'm already wounded. And now I gotta put on my gloves. You requiring more of me? When I'm in the middle of the wilderness, one thing I've learned about the enemy this past year, I hadn't even told Wendy this, is that he doesn't wait till you exit the wilderness to come against you. It's been one thing after another thing after another thing after another thing, and these ain't been minor issues in my world. These have been major crises in my world. We ain't even started talking about raising 2 teenagers in the house yet. Huh? I ain't even talked about financial hardship at times. He doesn't wait till you're feeling better to come against you. He doesn't wait till you get your tax refund check to come against you. He doesn't wait till you get back home in the safety of your family to come against you. No, he will attack you when you're most vulnerable, when you're already broke, busted, and disgusted, when you're at your weakest point, already feeling isolated and lonely. And before they were able to get where they were going, here comes the Canaanites. So if you think this thing is wrapping up, and we're fixing to learn to breathe again, I'll promise you spring's not going to come as early as you think. I think it's going to get harder before it gets easier. It's fixing to get worse before it gets better. My last name ain't Osteen. I'm not here, amen, for a pep rally. I'm here to tell you the God living truth right now, amen. And that is simply this. The truth of the fact of it is, amen, we better put on our boxing gloves, amen. We better get in the ring. We better get to exercise. And we better get in spiritual shape. Amen. We better start giving attention to where we're looking. Come on. You better get out of Facebook. You better get off of Twitter. Amen. You better get out of TikTok. You better get out of Snapchat. You better get out of this mess. Amen. You better get in the Word of God. Better get on your face. Better find you some Christian stations to listen to. Find you some preachers that plow your field. Amen. We better get ready for war. If not, you're going to die in the wilderness. Some already have. or using Facebook as an excuse not to come to church. I challenge you, turn Facebook off and be done with it. If you guys want to come to church, then show up. Room's big enough to put you 15 feet from all of us if you want to. We'll put you a little corner over by the door. Amen. You can wear your mask. Amen. We'll give you a bath and sanitize. Amen. You can just sit right over there where you ain't got to worry about nothing. Amen. But using Facebook as an excuse to continue staying at home, I'm telling you right now, is just showing you how spiritual deleted you are. Don't amen me. I know I'm right. I've already heard people say, well, we've been watching on live on Facebook for this long. It might as well just stay here at the house. There's something you can't get on live stream that you can only find, amen, right here in the house of God. And if that made you mad, it was for you. True to the fact of it is, I chose this text because the Canaanites come to fight the Israelites while they're in a wilderness. At a time of vulnerability, the enemy comes for war. While you're feeling unrested, unstable, undefined, dealing with overwhelming circumstances that are driving you off the deep end, that's when the enemy attacks, Brian. Amen. But I want you to know that in the middle of the unrest, in the middle of the trouble, in the middle of the storm, we have a God who will climb any mountain. He'll go to any lake. He'll cross any sea. Amen. To get to the middle of the mess you are in, to get right in the middle of the boat with you, right in the middle of the storm with you, right in the middle of the fire with you. And just like the enemy, I said just like the enemy, God won't wait either till everything's fixed before showing up. He'll climb right into the furnace with you. So as we leap into this text, we leap into it knowing that we have leaped into turbulence. We have leaped into unrest in these 8 verses. They're fishing to take on the Canaanites. They know they can't beat the Canaanites by themselves, so they go to God, ask God to deliver the Canaanites in their hand. God does. They win a great fight. Now all of a sudden, their spirits are sore. Their souls are discouraged. Amen. Next thing you know, amen, they start murmuring and complaining. Then all of a sudden, God sends snakes among them, starts wiping them out. People dying left and right. Amen. Comes out of nowhere. Now all of a sudden, they go to Moses. Moses, when you go to God, he goes to God. God takes away the snakes. He turns around and tells Moses, start a fire. Oh, start a fire. Huh? We need a meltdown. And whoever will look upon the brazen serpent shall live. Whoever looks up. Whoever looks up. It matters which way you look. We have leaped into chaos, confusion, and turmoil. We have leaped into a time of nervousness, anxiety, and unimaginable stress. Sounds like America? Yes, it does. We have leaped into a moment and time in the wilderness that the children of Israel has no place to lay their head. Amen. They can't afford to turn back to Egypt. That door's been closed. They can't reach the promised land. They're not there yet. They are stuck in this place of transition, and still the Canaanites came to attack them. And the Bible says in verse 2, and Israel vowed a vow unto the Lord and said, if Lord, O God, will indeed deliver the Canaanites into our hands, then we will utterly annihilate them. Isn't it nice to know that they associated victory not with the circumstances but with the presence of God? Huh? If you will fight for us, then we can get the victory. So many today, and many of you in this church, especially the one who called me this morning, is just a picture of me a month ago. So wrapped up in politics, brother, and then when it didn't go the way I thought it should go, oh my God, are you kidding me? Oh Lord Jesus, we're going to get it now. Oh God, 4 years of this. I've been running around saying that Obama couldn't break me in 8 years, Biden won't do it in 4. Huh? Right? And then all of a sudden, man, that Georgia runoff's going and bam, they get that too. And I'm thinking, oh my God, the border's going to be open. The nation's going to be flooded, amen, with immigrants that will vote Democrat. Amen, the Republicans will never get it back again. Now they're going to do this and they're going to do that. They're going to do this and they're going to do that. Then I got some good news. The first thing they're supposed to do is give me a $2,000 check. I thought, well, wait. You know, Mitch couldn't get it done. Maybe Nancy can. Huh? Oh, it always changes when it benefits me.
That's right. Come on.
Huh? Too many of God's people are waiting on the circumstances to be right before claiming victory. They didn't associate victory with the circumstances changing. They associated victory with nothing but the presence of God. It matters which way you look. I know it's 16 after 12. Something else I know. I'm not done yet. Too many God's people are waiting on the circumstances to be right before claiming victory. I'm going to say that again, Brian. Too many of us are waiting for the circumstances to change before we claim victory. Well, I'll be happy if they'll call me and apologize. Well, I'll be happy if I'll get a raise. Well, I'll be happy if she'll come back home. Well, I'll be happy if they call martial law. Come on. I'll be happy, amen, if this change. I'll be happy if that. I'll be happy if that. No, I'll tell you when you'll be happy. You'll be happy, amen, when you find the presence of God. And thy presence is fullness of joy. And at thy right hand are pleasures evermore. That's when you'll be happy. Waiting for the election to be overturned. Waiting for the Supreme Court to finally rule in our favor. Waiting for the lockdowns to live. Waiting for the government tyrants to drop dead. Then we will claim victory. Then we will beat our chest in triumph. I'm here to tell you that victory has never been in the circumstance. The victory has never been man-made. The victory has never been politically driven. The victory has always been and always will be the presence of God and nothing less but the presence of God. If God, nothing else but God. If God, nothing else but God. If God be for us, who can be against us? God plus nothing. God plus nobody. God plus no additions. If God, He alone is for me.
It's over, baby.
Whistle Dixie. Give God praise in this house if you believe that to be true right now. I've got a dilemma. I'm on page 8 and I'm trying to get to 24. It's 2 points and I got 3 left and we're just now getting to the best part of this message. You're welcome. I trust you'll be back tonight at 5:30. And at the very least, let me contradict myself. If you're not here, at least you'll watch it live. Whatever we have to do, however we have to do it to get this word in you. This is why I didn't want to preach this morning, because I'll have more time Monday night. You never have as much time on Sunday mornings because people's in a hurry to go eat. So I thought, well, I'd wait for Sunday night. I could preach it all in one lick. I even told them, amen, if they would, to record this morning's message. I want my dad to hear this tomorrow night. He's coming with me tomorrow night. Okay, I don't know where to go from here, so let me just fish my way through this. Wilderness. Let's just work that, man. Let's just work the wilderness. Let's work the wilderness. And a closing right now, let's work. You got to be back tonight, dude. I'm telling you, I got these last 3 points of this message is going to have you on your feet taking laps around this room. Okay, come on, guys. I'm not going to leave you hanging. I know it's been tough this morning, but I'm having to identify. You know what I'm having to do now? I'm having to tear. It's like pulling Velcro. I'm trying my best to detach you from fake news. I'm trying. Your septic tank ever been so full your commode won't flush, correct? It takes a truck to come out, number one, dig it up and find the lid. Then you got to raise that heavy lid and drop a big pipe in there and empty the thing. That's what I'm having to do right now, and this isn't easy, guys. Time does not allot me. The problem is you got more crap in your tank than I thought. Come on, amen, hello. Okay, so it's taking a little longer to pump it like me. Brian's rubbing his beard saying, ooh, that was close. We're all country folks around here. Don't act like yours don't stink. True to the fact of it is, man, as I believe with all of my heart, we got to get this out before we can get well. And I refuse to live. I sat over on the pew before he gave me the pulpit this morning. And I sat over and I thought, God, wouldn't it be awesome if this thing explodes and I've got to cancel my meeting next Sunday morning. And I wind up being here for 6 weeks, 7 weeks, 8 weeks. Just a news starts spreading through Spruce Pines, amen. There's something going on down there at that church. Wouldn't it be awesome You shake your head, yeah, but you don't want to pay the price for that because you've got ball games to attend. You've got jobs to work. You've got things to do, places to go, and things to be. And you know what? It's just too much of a sacrifice. I mean, that's kind of heavy, brother. Really? Too heavy in the climate we're living in right now in this country? If there's anything we need in this country, it's empty football stadiums and churches that are full. People are heartbroken. People are wounded. People are just doing crazy things, man. People are checking out. Young, middle-aged, old. I'm telling you, our world is not going to get any better as long as we just keep murmuring against God and Moses. Long as we keep complaining and fussing and griping. Part of what I was fixing to get into, and I'll get into it tonight, is can't we just be nice anymore? I'm having a hard time with that right now. I don't know, there's something about me that enjoys blowing my horn that people won't get out of my way. You know what that's telling me, Cody? That's telling me, man, that I need revival. I'm coming down the road a while ago, and I got an earbud, and it says Abby bought me an awesome set of Bluetooth earbuds for Christmas. Riding a row, I don't want to listen to them on the radio. I don't want to hear them chatting in the back seat. I don't want Wendy griping about how fast I'm driving. So I stick earbuds in both ears, and I turn me on some preaching. Well, I was trying to eat a Jack's biscuit. And I'm telling you right now, you cannot chew with earbuds in your ear. I learned that this morning. I stuffed them things down in there, almost took a hammer and hit myself in the side of the head to lodge that thing so deep in my eardrum, amen, that there's no way in the world it could fall out. I had them things packed in there, packed in my ears, picked that sandwich up, went to chew it, and I could hear it loosening up, feel it, and it falls out, hits the console, rolls down the floorboard. I took the other one out of my ear, just throw it on the desk. Just throw the temper, man. Because I couldn't chew and listen at the same time. I need revival too, guys. I'm a frustrated man. There's things that are going on, amen, in this world that has my water boiling. And I'm in the baby stages right now. Give me mercy, guys. Give me grace. At least I'm looking in the right direction. Come on, guys. You've got to start somewhere. I'll be one of the most transparent preachers you've ever heard before, because I'm going to tell you something. I won't only tell you, amen, that your socks stink. I'll tell you, amen, mine stink too. I won't just air out your mail. I'll air out mine first. So then I feel like I got a right to talk about yours. Listen to me. I'm just being honest with you today. I'm in the infancy stages too of making a comeback. I've been through a lot during 2020. I've been bedridden, man. I've just been locked down. I just get out of the bed and I'm back in it again. I get out of the bed, I'm back in it again. It's just been one of the most, but at the same time, I want to thank the Lord for 2020 preparing me for where He's about to take me. Because I'm going to be a different preacher. I'm going to be a different daddy. I'm going to be a different husband. I'll be a different son. And Brian will be a different friend. So rather than complaining about this wilderness, may I understand that, God, you have me here for a reason. And this isn't going to last forever. It's up to me how long it lasts. There's a good closing. It's up to me how long this bewilderment will last. It's called stinking thinking. And it all comes down to me understanding that it matters which way I look. Am I going to keep looking around? Am I going to keep, you know, that this one over here offended me, and that one over there I don't like, and this one over here, I wish that was God. I'd fix that great mess right there real quick. Huh? Oh, you've done it too. You know, you don't want them to die, but a broken leg would be really cool to hear about. Right? I mean, you don't want them to drop dead, but roll the car a few times without insurance, that would be awesome. And then on the way to work, you see them out doing this. Oh, just to get to pass them by one time. Huh? In your car. I keep looking around and allowing everything to deviate, distract my attention. I keep looking down. I look around or I look down. Defeated, discouraged, depressed, ready to throw my hands up and just quit and say, the heck with all of this. I look up unto the hills from which cometh my help. Come on, Cody. My help comes from the Lord. I know that's a verse that is so boring because you've heard it so often. It's lost its fizz. It's like a 30-day-old Dr. Pepper with no lid on it. I get it. I get it. But the Word of God still rings true. I will. It's a deliberate, intentional act of your own will. I will. Not my wife will, my kids will, my daddy will, and I hope you will. Not the government will, the state will, the city will. I will. It's about me. I will. Look unto the hills from which comes my help. My help comes from the Lord. And it shall be that whosoever has been bitten, if they will look up, they shall live. I'm just getting started with this. I got a feeling this same message is going to probably roll on through Wednesday. There's too much meat right here. I'm just getting into. I want you back tonight at 5:30. Please, let's pick up right now. We left off and let's start climbing. I need you here to help me climb higher. It matters to me that you're here. Your presence makes a difference being in this room. Please don't use it being cold. You go to Walmart when it's cold. You go to work when it's cold. You go to the ball games when it's cold. You go outside and get the mail when it's cold. You go get a newspaper when it's cold. Tonight at 5:30. 5:30, you'll be home plenty enough time to get plenty of rest tonight. It's sad in America you have to beg people to come back to church, especially in a time like this. 9 family members will stay home to wipe the snot off of 1 little 2-year-old's nose. Use anything excuse they can find not to be in the house of God. I'll be here. I hope you will as well. So for those few in this room who will pull their mask off and get honest with me, if you're in a state of bewilderment, any shape, form, or fashion, will you join me at this altar? I'm not going to stay here and look at you move. I'm going to move first. Will you join me at this altar as we endeavor on a comeback? Come on, guys. I know I'm not going to be alone. I know there's some of you in this room right now. They're saying within your heart, you know what, man, I've been here too long. I'm not having another year like last year. If you're not physically able to come to the front, build an altar right where you're sitting right now. And ask God to give you strength to bring an end to this bewilderment. Go ahead, bro.
Splendor of a king, cold and majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. Wraps himself in light, the darkness tries to hide. Trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God, sing with me. How great is our God, and all sing. How great is our God. Time is in his hands, the beginning and the end, the beginning and the end. God in 3 and 1, blessed Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Oh, sing, how great is our God. Name above all names, you are worthy of our praise. Now my heart will sing, how great is our God. So the name our God.